Our next lecture is about the p-n junction, right? So somebody asked, you know, why can we use only p-type or n-type semiconductor? Answer is no, we have to use p-n junction in order to make a solar cell. Okay, so let me start the next thing, continuity equation and p-n junction solar cell. In the last lecture, we have discussed about the carrier generation recombination, direct and indirect band gap semiconductor, absorption coefficient, absorption length, recombination mechanism, carrier lifetime, and so on. Here we are actually going to discuss continuity equation. Continuity equation is one equation which is which if you solve that equation, you can get the performance of your device. Or basically, continuity equation is the starting point of your solution in order to get the equation for your device, right? Everybody knows the equation for the p-n junction diode. What is the equation for p-n junction diode? I equal to I 0 e raised to power q v by k t minus 1. So that is equation for p-n junction diode, and that equation actually the starting point of derivation of that equation is nothing but the continuity equation. So continuity equation we'll discuss, and the most important thing is p-n junction, because my p-n junction acts as a solar cell. Now see, we started from the very fundamentals. We looked at the solar radiation, we looked at the various parameters of a semiconductor, mainly the four events: charge creation, charge transport, generation, recombination. Now we will all put all this together in the form of continuity equation, so that we can know how solar cell is going to perform. Okay, so this is what we discussed: minority carrier lifetime, and then we have discussed that you know, the excess carrier concentration will decrease exponentially with respect to time, and the characteristic of the exponential decay will be minority carrier lifetime. That we have seen, this is just revision. We have also seen that the change in the majority carrier concentration is not significant, but the change in the minority carrier concentration with respect to time is significant. So we have seen this with respect to time. We have to also see the what happens with respect to distance, right? So continuity equation is actually the equation which takes all kind of actions taking place on a carrier, right? So in a device, the p-n junction you can consider as a box, and when light falls on it, carrier generates, there is a thermal generation taking place, there is a carrier drift taking place, there is a carrier diffusion taking place, and when you connect the solar cell to external load, the current is flowing outside and some current is inside. So basically, within a p-n junction diode, lot of things are taking place, and once we actually combine, put all this behavior together in some equation form, then we can solve that equation with a proper boundary condition. And once we solve this with the proper boundary condition, we get the current voltage behavior of a device. And in this case, what is our interest? Our interest is to find out the current voltage behavior of a solar cell. Okay, so continuity equation is this. You look at the black box here, there is some box. Okay, so some current is going in by JP. J is, by the way, current density. Okay, so and P is for the holes. So some hole current is going in this box, some hole current is coming out. Okay, some generation is taking place, some recombination is taking place. So these are all the events that is taking place, and within this, because current is going in and out, what else is taking place? Drift is taking place and diffusion is also taking place. Drift is taking place and diffusion is also taking place. Okay, so if I want to summarize this, whatever is taking place in this box, if I want to summarize this, I can put it like this, that the rate of change of hole concentration with respect to time within this box, okay, the hole concentration, first of all, some current is coming inside the box, which means which is increasing the current, hole concentration, right? Some current is going out of the box, which is decreasing the hole concentration. Some generation is taking place inside the box, which is again increasing the hole concentration, and some recombination is taking place, which is reducing the hole concentration. So that is I want to put here, that so this part is actually taking care of the current which is coming in, current which is going out. Within this is taking within the distance x plus del dx. So within the dx delta x, this is taking place. What is this term? Excess carrier concentration divided by the minority carrier lifetime. What is this? Rate of recombination, and g is the generation rate. Okay. Now by my differential, this thing, the I have to put minus here, because my final current minus initial current divided by delta. So I have to change this term here, and that's why minus will come here. So basically, the rate of change of hole concentration with respect to time and distance x and t, right? Now we are talking about change in the concentration, both x and t, can be governed by this equation, and this is called the continuity. It takes care of the generation, it takes care of the recombination, it takes care of the current which is leaving, it takes care of the current which is coming. So basically drift, diffusion, recombination, generation, everything is taken care in this equation, and if you solve this equation I get the solution for my device, continuity equation. Okay. Continuity equation can be simplified in various ways, right? We'll come back to that why I need to simplify. Current, as I said, discussed, can be because of the drift and it can be because of the diffusion. Current because of the drift depends on the electric field. Current because of the diffusion depends on the concentration gradient, right? If the electric field is 0, drift current is 0. If the electric field is 0, drift current is 0. So in many cases, what happens in your semiconductor, there is no electric field. And therefore, what is possible? If the electric field is 0, then the current will only because of the diffusion. Okay, so the drift current component will become 0, it is only because of diffusion. And in that case, I am going to put here this current, in this current will only be diffusion current. So if I do that, then my continuity equation becomes a diffusion equation, simple equation, right? The drift current component part is not there. So assumption is that your zeta equal to 0, which means electric field is equal to 0. And that is actually true for the many parts of the device, we will come back to that. So when I solve the diffusion equation for the various solutions, so let us how the diffusion equation has come now. Same thing here, J is this, and when I put J here, so this is the diffusion, assumption is E zeta equal to 0, electric field is 0. So my current is only because of the concentration gradient, which is a diffusion current component. If I put this into this, here, I get this equation. Okay, this is called my magnetic area diffusion equation. Okay, so magnetic area diffusion equation can have a many simple solution, and that is what we'll discuss here. Okay, so remember this is your magnetic area diffusion equation. Okay, the rate of change of delta n with respect to time, so second order differential with respect to x, so it takes care of the change with respect to time, it takes care of the change with respect to distance, and this is what is the rate, recombination rate, generation rate. So what is my situation? I am talking about steady state. Okay, so what is steady state? Steady state means, steady state means no change with time, no change with time. Okay, so when there is no change with time, what will happen to this term? It will become 0. This is called steady state. Okay, what is the other possible situation? The concentration, no change in the concentration, no change in concentration. When there is no change in concentration, what will happen to this term and second order? I am writing for the hole, but same thing can be written for the electron also, right? When there is no change in concentration, this will become 0. When no change with respect to time, this is 0. When no change with respect to concentration, this becomes 0. When there is no generation, due to light, then what term is 0? G equal to 0. No generation with light, G equal to 0. Okay, and then when there is no recombination, then your delta p by tau p, that is recombination rate, this equal to 0. Okay, so these are the four situations in which four different terms that appears in diffusion equation can be 0. Steady state, no change with time, this is 0. No change in the concentration, this is 0. No generation rate, G equal to 0. No recombination, this is equal to 0. So that is what is the steady state, this is 0. Okay, so what is steady state and no light? No light means no generation, so G is also 0. Okay, so this is your simplified equation now, simplified diffusion equation, and if you solve this, this is a second order differential equation with 0, right hand side is 0, so you will get this kind of solution. Okay, you get this kind of solution, and let me put again this kind of solution. So so your solution is change in the delta with respect to x, because with respect to time there is no change, so this term is anyway 0, so what is changing is only with respect to it. So delta p with respect is equal to some constant e raised to the power minus x over lp plus B plus. Okay. And notice what is already when you solve is there ln and LP is, so here I am talking about LP is equal to square root of DP and tau P. Okay. Diffusion length, this comes from this solving this equation. Again, due to the shortage of time, I am sorry, I am not going there, but when you solve that equation, when you solve that equation, you will find that when you file that, one of the factor that comes is square root term of this, which has a unit of length. Okay, and that the square root of d and tau, what is the unit of this? So unit of d, diffusion coefficient, is centimeter square per second. Tau is the lifetime, has the unit of second. So square root of centimeter is centimeter. Okay, so it is nothing but the unit of length, and that is why this factor LP equal to square root of dp or tau p is called the, so as having length, and it is called the diffusion length. Okay, it is called the diffusion length. Okay, diffusion length of minority carriers. Again, we are talking about minority carrier. Why? Because we are talking about diffusion, and diffusion, the concentration gradient for majority carrier is not there. It's a minority carrier that results in a significant concentration gradient, and therefore diffusion. Again, in this term, this will component will become, B will become 0, right, because this is positive term. So, your carrier concentration cannot increase, it is only going to decrease, and therefore, which means the B term has to be 0. So, basically your excess whole concentration, minority whole concentration will have some term, some constant A, which is e raised to minus x over LP. Okay. So, with respect to distance, what happens there? We are earlier we have seen with respect to time, if there is a recombination taking place, what happens with respect to time, there is exponential decay. Same thing we are seeing here. Now, with respect to distance, your delta p, excess whole concentration, will decay exponentially, and this is x distance, and this characteristic slope will be e minus x over lp, right. So, two important thing to learn, if there is excess carrier concentration, the excess carrier concentration decreases exponentially with respect to time due to the recombination. Also, the excess carrier concentration decreases exponentially with respect to distance due to recombination. Okay. So, an earlier case, if the time variation is there, if things are varying with the time, this is, by the way, the previous case, not here. This is the previous case, not here. So, there we have say delta p with respect to time is varying exponentially, and the characteristic was t over tau p. And if the change is occurring with respect to distance, the decay will be exponential again, and the characteristic here is LP, diffusion length. Okay, lifetime, tau p is a lifetime, LP is a diffusion length. Again, very two important material parameters for solar cell. Other two important parameter I talked about is mobility and diffusion coefficient, and the next two parameters is carrier lifetime, minority carrier lifetime, and diffusion length. Minority carrier lifetime is, what is the minority carrier lifetime? So, let me put those parameters so that you remember. So, mobility is important, d is important, okay, tau is important, l is important. Diffusion length is the average length traveled by a charge carrier before it recumbents, right. What is happening here with respect to x? So, carriers will actually diffuse and eventually reduce, right. And they will recombining, right. This is due to the recombination, the average length that is traveled. Similarly, for the, when you are talking about the with respect to time, with respect to time, when the carrier concentration decreases, when it decreases to certain level, we say it is the carrier lifetime. Mobility is the ease with which the carrier flow in a semiconductor. Diffusion coefficient is the ease with which the carrier diffuse in the semiconductor. Okay. So, these are the four most important parameters a scientist working in a solar PV is worried always. Okay. Whether you are developing cadmium telluride solar cell or amorphous silicon solar cell or silicon solar cell or gallium arsenide, any solar cell that you develop in the world, mobility, diffusion coefficient, carrier lifetime, diffusion length, right. For the, let me give the units again, this is the unit of length typically given in micrometer, unit of time, it is given in microsecond, okay. Mobility unit is centimeter square old per old second, diffusion coefficient is centimeter square per second, okay. Typical diffusion length of the carrier, I am talking about silicon now, okay. Let me take the example of silicon. Typical diffusion length of the carrier, that is the average length the carrier travel before they recombine, is about 100 200 micrometer. Typical lifetime of a silicon, that is the carrier spent in the excited state before they recombine, is about 1 to 10 microsecond. Typical mobility, now both of these are for both holes and electron, okay. You have to look at the holes and electrons. So mobility for holes is electrons normally higher, about 1400 200, and for the holes it is lower. Diffusion coefficient is 35 for electron. I'll give the summary of this, so don't worry about this. So this is for electron, and you get about 400 for the hole, okay. These are the typical number, please remember. These are the first of all four important parameters. You must understand the significance of each of them, because they are very important for the solar cell operation. You should know rough value of mobility, diffusion coefficient, lifetime and diffusion length, okay. And these are important when it comes to the diffusion. And in this, we are trying to look at the diffusion equation, where only the diffusion is taking place, right. Remember, in the previous slide, we already assumed that electric field is 0. So, we are not considering the drift. And in the later slide, I will tell you why this decision is correct, that we do not have to worry about the drift. Most of the time in the solar cell, you have to worry about the diffusion, okay. So, under this condition, steady state and no light, you will get this solution. Under this condition, no concentration gradient, okay, means this term is 0, right. No concentration gradient means this term is 0, no light means G is equal to 0. So, you get this, which is the variation of excess carrier with respect to time. We have seen already the solution, right, very nice. So, this is shows the variation with respect to distance due to the recombination, because the recombination term is non-zero here. Here also recombination term is non-zero. So, change in the concentration with respect to time when the recombination is taking place, and that is also exponential decay with respect to time. Steady state and no concentration gradient. Steady state means this term is 0, concentration gradient, no concentration gradient means this term is 0, both these terms are 0. So, what is left is this, okay. So, what does it mean? So, excess carrier concentration is a function of lifetime and generation rate. The unit of generation rate is per unit volume per unit time. So, when you multiply with the time, you get the excess carrier concentration, okay. So, when you are putting some light, how much is the excess carrier concentration? Then you can find out from this. So, this is the way simple solution you can get, okay. So, this is one example which shows that. Let me explain you, this is in your tutorial. This problem is in your tutorial. So, I have a semiconductor like this, okay. X equal to 0 here, X equal to 0, and this is X equal to L. So, L is the thickness of the silicon. Light is falling on it from this side. So, what we have discussed in the absorption, when we discussed absorption, that if the high energy photon, it will absorb very close to the surface. If it is a low energy photon or a low absorption coefficient photon, it will go deeper, okay. So, assume that I am talking about high energy photon, okay. So, absorption is taking place only here. Absorption is taking place only here. So, as a result of that, what is happening here? Close to the surface, you are creating excess holes. Let us say this is my n type semiconductor. So, my minority carriers are holes. So, I am talking about excess holes. So, because you are using high energy photons, your absorption coefficient of high energy photons is high, and therefore, most of the photon get absorbed very close to the surface, maybe 50 nanometer, 100 nanometer, depending on the wavelength. So, this excess carrier concentration is, and this is continuously happening, okay. Your light is not off, it is continuously on, continuously on. What will happen now? So, if I plot the t equal to 0 scenario, your situation was in a equilibrium. So, you have this, this is your P 0, equilibrium carrier concentration. Because of the light falling, your some of the carriers are generated here, okay. This is also P 0, this is P now, right. Carriers are generated here. So, what you see here? This is x, this is a concentration axis. What do you see the difference here? Concentration difference. So, because of this concentration difference, this carrier will diffuse in this direction. Carrier will diffuse, okay. How they will diffuse? how they will diffuse? Look at the solution of my minor TK diffusion equation. How they will diffuse? Exponentially. What is the exponential factor? Diffusion length. Okay, they will diffuse with the characteristic figure of diffusion length. Okay. So, this carrier will, excess carrier will diffuse, and this exponential curve, shape of the exponential curve will depend on the diffusion length LP. As long as you are putting the light, this will take place. As long as you are putting the light, your carrier will keep on diffusing, and the profile will become almost stable. Okay. And this is what also happens in solar cell, because when you are putting the light continuously, continuous generation is taking place someplace, then you are diffusing. So, this is what we have, and you please solve this problem. This problem is nothing, very simple. So, what is given is the doping level is given, excess carrier concentration is given at the surface, and then it will diffuse. So, basically you need to plot at various depths what is the remaining carrier concentration. It is nothing but a simple exponential decay function. So, do this in a tutorial. Okay, quasi Fermi level we do not bother about, again shortage of the time, but basically what happens, your Fermi level changes when you are putting light, but because of the light you are actually creating extra electron in hole, and electron in hole result in the shift in the Fermi level that we have discussed, right. Because of the doping, you actually create more electron or more hole, and because of that your Fermi level shifts either closer to the conduction band or away from the conduction band. Similarly, either closer to the valence band or away from the valence band. Similarly, when you put a light on it, you both electron and hole is changing, concentration is changing, and therefore you will change the Fermi level position. Okay, so now, so the continuity equation and what happens under the specific condition when there is no change in the time, when there is no change in the concentration gradient, when there is no recombination or no generation. So, now the most important thing is now the p-n junction which acts as a solar cell. How to make a p-n junction? Take a p-type and take a n-type, put them together, make a p-n junction. By the way, can a simple semiconductor be used to generate the power? Okay, that is more important question. Somebody has asked this. Can I use a only n-type semiconductor or p-type semiconductor to generate power? Okay. Who will give me the answer? You will give me the answer. Okay. Okay. So let me give this example that if I keep my pen here, if I keep my pen here, this is my table here. Right? Where is the pen going? No, it is not going anywhere. Why it is not going anywhere? Because it is a equipotential surface. The potential energy of each heat point is equal, right. So, my pen is not going here, right. Instead of this, if I create a difference in the level, right. So, I take another thing, now you created a difference in energy level, right. So, at this point potential energy is higher, and at this point potential energy is lower, right. If I keep my pen here, now what will happen? See what is happening? My pen is always going from low energy to high energy, right. My pen is always going to low energy to high energy, right. So, the automatic moment of an object will occur when there is a different energy level, right. So, now coming back here to the whiteboard, that this is what is my this axis, potential energy, and this is distance. Okay. What do I see? Potential energy, this is a flat line, right. This is my conduction band edge, this is my valence band edge. The line is flat, which means potential energy at this point, at this point, at this point, at this point, at every point is same, right. Potential energy at every point is same. What does it mean? If I put a light on it, and if I create a electron and a hole here, in which direction the electron will go? If it is not recombining, which direction will electron will go? Here, here or here? It can go either direction, right. Because energy levels are same. Energy levels are same. So conduction band, when it is a flat, it is a constant potential energy level. So, once electron is generated, it can go either here, and it can go either here also, right. So, if half of the electron is moving one side, half of the electron is moving one side, the net motion of the charge is 0, and the net motion of the charge is 0 means no current, right. So, basically which means, if you have only flat energy bands, electron current conduction is not possible, it is not possible, right. So, what you need to do? You need to create a difference in the potential energy, right. What does it mean? If I somehow have a level like this and a level like this, okay, what do you see now here? This point potential energy is higher, this point it is lower, this point even lower, this point even lower, this point even lower. Okay. Now, if my generation takes place here, what will happen to this electron? Okay, what will happen to this electron? Will it go left hand side or it will go right hand side? Answer is, it will always go right hand side, right? Because it is going down in energy. This electron will always go down in energy, right? So I need to create that energy level difference so that my electron goes one side, my holes go one side, I create positive charge one side, negative charge other side, and I generate that voltage, and therefore my direction of current should be U1. Okay, electron should not be confused, some electron go this side, some go other side, and no current flows. Got it? Very. So I hope this point should be clear to all of you, that potential energy, so single semiconductor, either it is a p-type or n-type, can never act as a solar cell. You require two semiconductor, one is p and one is n, so that you can create this kind of energy, potential energy difference, and that is important. Okay, so you make a p-n junction, take a p-type and n-type. I will give a separate lecture on actually how in industry we make solar cells, so we will not spend time on this. So this is what happens. Okay, when you take a p-type, so this is your p-type semiconductor, look at here, Fermi level is close to the valence band. This is your n-type semiconductor, Fermi level is close to the conduction band. When you put them together, one thing happens, that again due to the shortage of time I have not discussed with you, one thing happens is the Fermi level aligns. Okay, Fermi level of materials in contact with each other remains same at equilibrium. Okay, whatever you do, right, whatever you do, Fermi level of two materials in contact with each other at equilibrium always remains same. So what does it mean? If I have a p-type semiconductor with Fermi level here, I have n-type semiconductor with Fermi level here, in equilibrium, even if I put 5 semiconductors together, Fermi levels is always going to be constant for all those 5. Okay, and this is a very important theory behind it, that if Fermi level is not constant, some energy will automatically flow from one semiconductor to other semiconductor, and that is not possible. That is not possible, right? Otherwise, you will have immediately some voltage generated. That is not possible, and therefore that requires that Fermi level should be same. So when you want to draw the band diagram of p and n together, right, this is a band diagram, this is the band diagram, or energy band diagram to be more precise, energy band diagram for the p type, and this is energy band diagram for the n type. Okay, I want to draw the energy band diagram of p n junction together. How to draw it? Energy band diagram of p n junction. How to draw it? So because my Fermi level is constant throughout the material, whether it is a 1 or 2 or 3 or 4 or 5, whatever number of materials, I need to draw first of all a constant line, and this line is now my Fermi level. Okay. Now with respect to my Fermi level, I can draw other energy level, right. So in p type semiconductor, my valence band is close to the Fermi level and my conduction band is here. So this is my p type now side. In the n type, my conduction band is close to the Fermi level, and then this gap is equal to the band gap. Then I have the conduction band, and this gap is equal to the band gap. What happens in between? In between, you have to have the smooth connection. Okay, so this is the way you can actually draw the band diagram of p-n junction. Any material, right? You can. Now, so this is your n type. Now, so this band gap should match. This band gap should match equal to your silicon. So both p-type is silicon, n-type is silicon. You have to make 1.1. Okay. Sometime p-type can be silicon, n-type can be germanium. Is that possible? Yes, that is possible. In cadmium telluride solar cell, for example, cadmium telluride itself is a p-type, and it makes a junction with the cadmium sulfide. So actual cadmium telluride solar cell is nothing but a cadmium telluride solar cell is cadmium sulfide and cadmium telluride. So this is how the junction is made. This is p-type and this is n-type. In crystalline silicon solar cell, both p type is crystalline silicon, n type is also crystalline silicon, but in cadmium telluride this is like this. Same thing with CIGS. In CIGS also you have the n type cadmium sulfide, and CIGS is p type. So this is your p type, this is your n type. Okay, so easy to plot a band diagram, draw the Fermi level constant, and then with respect to Fermi level you draw your valence band and conduction band both for both p type and n. So this is what I have done here. with respect to Fermi level, you draw your valence band and conduction band. Look at this thin dotted line, this is the Fermi level where it remains constant, and that is the theory that you have to follow, that under equilibrium condition, any materials putting together, Fermi level remains same everywhere. Okay. Now, we are coming closer to the operation of a p-n junction, and then we look at the solar cell. So, in p-n junction, in the p-type n-type semiconductor, you have lot many electrons and there are many. So, electrons are the mobile carriers, right? Electron is the one which is donated, but after donating the electron, the phosphorus atom becomes positive charge, right? That you have seen. Phosphorus atom become positive charge. In p-type, boron is there, boron takes electron, by taking electron it becomes negative. But there is a hole which is there, which is positive, right. So, that is why. Now, this phosphorus atom itself cannot move in a lattice, but this electron which is donated can move around, right. Similarly, boron after taking an electron, the boron atom is fixed, but the hole which is created is moving, right. So, that is why I am in here, the charge carrier which is shown by the circle is actually mobile carriers, and the fixed charges, the charges which are shown by the rectangle, are actually charges due to the atom, okay. And this is true, right, the charge neutrality has to maintain the total positive charge is equal to total negative charge, okay. So, in p-n junction, we have this kind of situation at t equal to 0. Now, look at this mobile electrons which are there, many mobile electrons at the n side, and there are many mobile holes at the p side, right. There are many mobile electrons at the n side, there are many mobile holes at the p side. So, this when this electron, so basically when you connect them together, what should happen? Okay. There is a concentration difference of electron at one side and less electron at the other side, right. More electrons at the n side, less electrons at the p side. So, there is a concentration difference of electron. So, electron actually must diffuse from n side to p side, right. Similarly, holes. Holes are mobile in the p side, there are lot many holes in the p side, but less holes in the n side. So, lot of holes should actually move from p side to n side. And this, why they should move? They should move because of the difference in concentration. Therefore, it is called diffusion. Diffusion should take place. Okay, it does take place indeed. Indeed it does take place. So, after this electron here, it goes there, this hole comes here, and they recombine with each other. You know, as I said, when diffusion takes place, the carrier moves and they recombine. Minority carriers, they move and they recombine with exponential decay that we have seen. Okay. So, should the, how long the diffusion should take place? Should all the carriers should actually merge with each other and die out, or what will happen? So, when the electron is leaving behind a fixed positive atom, phosphorus atom, you create a layer of positive charges, and this, when the hole is moving, it leaves behind a fixed negative charges, and what these fixed charges are? Okay. So earlier there was a phosphorus atom which was positive charge, and there was an electron. Okay, and this is my junction, phosphorus atom and electron, phosphorus atom and electron. Then I have a boron minus and a hole, boron minus and a hole, boron minus and a hole. This is at time t equal to 0. When you just brought them together, now you are allowing them to move. So, this electron will go and recombine with here, or this vice versa. So, this will recombine with this, this will recombine with, there are many others, right. There are many electrons here and there are many holes at this side also, right. We are not taking, we are just looking at the interface. So, after that, what you will have? You will have the positive charge, these are the positive charges which is left behind, these are the negative charges which is because of the boron atom, these are the positive charges because of the phosphorus atom, they are fixed, they cannot move, right? Atom cannot move. So, what do you see now? One side of the line there is positive charge, other side of the line there is a negative charge, okay. So, positive charge separated by negative charge, you have a electric field, okay. There is electric field now. Electric field is set up because of this with this direction, okay. So, this electric field will do what? So, now because there is electric field, remember this is the p side and this is n side, right. There are lot many holes here, right. This electric field in this direction and force on the holes is also in this direction. So, this electric field will not allow hole to come in this direction, right, because the electric field will repel it. Right. Similarly, force on electron is in the opposite direction of electric field, and therefore, it will not, this electric field will not allow electron to come again, more electron to come, and therefore, after some time this electric field that will set up, it will stop the flow of majority carrier from n side to p side, and it will also stop the flow of majority holes from p side to n side, and therefore, the electric field is generated at the junction, and corresponding to electric field there is a built in voltage, right. So, electric field is generated and corresponding to that there is a built in voltage. So, this slide is a good summary of what is happening at a PN junction under equilibrium condition, right. What is happening at the PN junction under equilibrium condition. All this expression can be derived, but again we are running out of time. So, we will not have that. All the derivation I am leaving for you only. This is for you homework, all the homework you do after the course is over or whenever you get time. Okay. All this derivation, all this are given in my book. You can read that and do it. I am just giving you the concepts. So, there is electric field that exists and look at here. This is the PN junction diagram now. So, here the band is flat. So, no electric field. Here the band is flat, no electric field. In the junction, near the junction, band is not flat. Means potential energy is different at different point, which means there is electric field. Similarly, potential energy is different point there is electric field. Which side is this side? Fermi level is close to the conduction band. So, it is n type, or you can see there are a lot of electron sitting here. So, it is n type. Which side is this side? P type, lot of holes are here, or we can say Fermi level is close to the valence band. Very nice. What is this electron here? Remember in the P side, if your doping is 10 to the power 16, still there are 10 to the power 4 electrons are there, is not it? N0 P0 equal to Ni square. So, even if there are a lot of holes, there are some electrons. Similarly, in N type, there are a lot of electrons, but there are some holes. What is happening with this electron and hole? What is happening with this electron and hole? Okay. Now, once you have the carrier, what will happen? Carrier will move. How the carrier moves? Either drift or diffusion. Two things can happen. For the N type, for the electron, this carrier cannot move this side. There are lot many electrons here and less electrons here. So, diffusion should occur in principle, right, because of the concentration gradient, but it will not occur because this electron will have to rise in terms of the energy. Remember, what is this axis? So, I have this energy band diagram. Okay, there are lot many electrons here. There are lot many electrons are here. This electron cannot go there, they want to go because of the concentration difference, but because the energy, this is the energy level, right? Energy at this side is high, but possibly this electron can go. Okay. So, the motion of this electron will be what? This electron is going here because of the diffusion. So, this is a diffusion reaction of electron, diffusion, right. Now, there are many holes here. This is the P side, this is the P side, and this is N side. There are many holes here, but there are some electrons here. Can this electron come down? Yes, because it is going down in energy, right. Anything which is going down can happen automatically, right. Like my pen comes down automatically. So, this electron can come automatically and also it experiences electric field. Okay. What is the direction of electric field? Direction of electric field is always uphill. Okay. Take a thumbnail. Direction of electric field is uphill and therefore, force on electron is in this direction. Force on electron in this direction. Therefore, this electron will come under the force of this electric field and therefore, this electron will move here under the force. It is called the drift. Okay. So, diffusion of electron will take place, drift of electron will take place. Similarly, this hole cannot go there because it, by the way, hole energy increases this time, right. So, this is energy of electron and this is hole energy. Hole energy increases downwards. So, this hole cannot go there, but this hole can go there. This hole will go there because of the concentration difference. So, this is the diffusion of hole. Now, similar to this, there are lot many inside, there are lot many electrons, but there are some holes also there. And this hole will have the force on this direction. So, this hole will actually come and this motion of the hole will be drift. So, in this condition everything is happening, drift of electron, diffusion of holes, drift of holes, everything will happen and that is what I have shown here. Everything is happening. It is thermal equilibrium, means the situation is not disturbed, no light is falling, no bias is applied, no magnetic field, nothing is there, it is all equilibrium, but it is a PN junction. Because nothing is happening, no contact is made, so net current has to be 0, is not it? In your PN junction device, net current has to be 0, so it is 0. But the individual current components are not 0. There is electron drift taking place, there is an electron hole diffusion taking place, there is a hole drift taking place, there is a hole diffusion taking place. All this event taking place in a semiconductor all the time, such that the net motion of charge is 0. And that is what is the situation of a PN junction diode when no light is applied, no bias is applied. Okay. So, in the next lecture, we will see what will happen if you put light on it. Before that, we will see what will happen if you put bias on it. Okay. So, this is actually your PN junction, and by understanding this graph, you can actually understand what is happening to the operation of your PN junction, right? So, far so clear. So, we have discussed lot of thing about semiconductor. We have come to the PN junction theory, and we are utilizing what we have learned. We are utilizing why diffusion occurs, we are utilizing why drift occurs, we are utilizing about what is the meaning when the flat band is there, what is the meaning when the band is filled, means the difference in the potential energy is basically electric field. Okay, so we are utilizing our knowledge whatever we have discussed, and with this we are coming closer to learning how solar cell results in a generation of voltage when light falls on it. Okay. Jaicham Rajendra College.
Do we get sufficient power generation when we keep our solar panels under artificial lighting during nights?
Well, first if you have to define what is sufficient for you. If you define sufficient level, then yes. I mean, if you want microwatt power, yes, it is possible. But otherwise, the intensity is low that it is not going to be useful.
Can we light up one light at least? Such a type of power generation is possible.
No, again, what light you want to light up? If you want to light up, 0.1 milliwatt LED, yes, possible, but otherwise not. And remember, what is the energy of the photon has to be higher than the band gap of the material. So that is important. Okay, there is a question from COAP. Direction of drift current due to electron and hole is the same direction. Then how it is opposite direction in partial flow you shown in the slide junction at thermal equilibrium. Okay, think about it yourself, and when we discussed about the direction of drift current for electron and hole is again in the same direction, or the particle flow is different, okay, because of the different energy level. So think about yourself, normally the way to look for the direction of the current is first find out what is the driving force. Okay, so driving force is I'll show you for those who are not clear. So whenever you want to find out the direction of current, first look at the driving force. Okay, so driving force is the electric field. Draw electric field. Okay, this electric field exert a force on a particle, electron and hole in a different direction. Okay, so the force on electron is in this direction. Okay, force on electron, the force on hole in this direction. So that is the next step. Okay, so this is the driving force, this is the motion it is acting, and due to this motion, when electron is going in this direction, our convention is that the current flows in this direction. So this is the electron current, and therefore my hole is also going in the direction. The convention is that the hole flow is in the same direction as the current flow. So this is my both the direction of the current. Okay. So in the PN junction also that I have shown, actually electron is moving in this direction due to the drift, but the electron current is flowing in the opposite direction. Similarly, hole drift is flowing in this direction, and the hole drift current is in the same direction. So again, direction of electron drift current and direction of hole drift current is same, not different. Whatever I have shown here is the direction of the particle only, not this is not the direction of current. Direction of currents is here. Okay, look at the hole drift, yellow line, and the electron drift, yellow line, both are in the same direction. Hole diffusion and electron diffusion, both are in the same direction. So this is the current flow, this is the particle flow, which means electron and hole. How does the PN junction produce the potential difference? You have already said that P type and N type are individually neutral. So that is why shown when the carrier flows here, the sum of the carriers recombine at the interface. Okay, so at some portion of the interface there is only positive charge, and some portion of interface there is only negative charge. So only at the interface you have the electric field, rest of the place is still neutral. Okay, this portion of the semiconductor is still neutral, this portion of the semiconductor is still neutral. In between there is electric field for a very small portion. Okay, this may be less than half micron. If your material is 180 micron thick, only about a half a micron of the silicon will have the electric field. Okay, does the P type and N type material should have the same band gap? Answer is yes. Crystalline silicon, if the material is same, the band gap of the P type and N type remains the same. Jaipur College.
Sir, actually we have performed one of the experiments like tracking of sun, and in that we have plotted VI characteristic.
Okay.
And for every time duration we have noted that maximum power is continuously decreasing in nature. So could you please elaborate why it is happening, what is the reason behind it, and what is the advantage if such kind of solar system is synchronized with the our power system?
So if I understand correctly, you are measuring the IV characteristic in a tracking mode, but every time you do the measurement, your power, peak power is going down, right?
Yes, sir.
Okay, so how much time you have taken to perform this experiment?
Sir, we have taken 15 minutes for every reading.
So one possible reason could be that, you know, this point of the time you are in Jaipur, you know, so it is the sun may be setting down very fast, so the intensity of the radiation is decreasing fast, and therefore, you know, what happens when you actually doing your experiment, if the intensity is maintained constant. So what you should do actually is that if you normalize your power, so for each experiment are you measuring the power also, solar radiation also or not? So what you should do for each experiment, you should measure your peak power, okay, and you should measure the solar intensity, right? And if you actually normalize these two, if you normalize peak power per solar intensity, then I think that problem will not be there, because I guess that at this time of the hour your sun is setting fast, and therefore your, though you are making your, with the tracking you are trying to get the best possible output, but because your input intensity itself is going down, and therefore your peak power is also going down. So if you,
so my general question is like, sir, whether it is like in practical system when we are doing this kind of system, tracking system, whether this maximum power is decreasing or not, or it will be remain constant?
No, it definitely will decrease. So maximum power, see, what is the point is like this, that normally this is the IV curve of the solar cell or module, right? So this is your current axis, this is your voltage axis. So this point of, if cell is operating at this point or module is operating this point, your power is zero because voltage is zero. If the module is operating at this point, your power is zero because your voltage is zero, your current is zero, okay? And there may be some other operating points. And we, when you plot the power versus voltage, you will find that there is only one point where the you get the peak power. Now this peak power is not constant, it is a function of a intensity, it is a function of intensity. Or if I explain you in another way, that if you plot the efficiency, it is what? Peak power output divided by power input. Now I am worrying about the power output, so I can write power output is equal to efficiency times power input. Now my efficiency of the module is not changing, right? Once you make your module, efficiency is fixed. So what is changing? Your input power is changing. So when your input power intensity will go down, your output power will also go down, even though you are tracking.
Yes, sir. So whether some advantages or disadvantages are attached to such kind of system?
No, so when you are doing the tracking,
when we synchronize such kind of system with a power system.
So when you are doing the tracking, actually you are trying to get collect more radiation. So if you are not taking, if you are not doing the sun tracking, your actual output will be lower than the case when you are doing the tracking for the same condition. So you do actually get an example, and you collect more energy by doing the tracking, and that your experiment should show that.
Thank you, sir.
Okay, Amal Jyoti College, Kerala.
Sir, our doubt is actually the reduction in efficiency. It's mainly due to recombination. Is there any other reason for the reduction in efficiency or reduction in absorption of the photons by the material?
So when the solar cell is fabricated, the recombination takes place always, right? So it is the design of the solar cell, the material of the solar cell, the processing of a solar cell that determines the recombination, right? Now once you made your solar cell and put into the field in the form of module, but when your module is going down the, you know, day and night, temperature is changing, there is a humidity change, and so on. So the contact between the semiconductor and metal also degrades over a period of time, but that time is a longer, you know, years and years and years. So there are other mechanism also that results in a decrease in the efficiency.
Sir, for fresh photovoltaic cell,
mm-hmm.
It won't, the efficiency is less. The reason is, the main reason is recombination.
Well, the reason could be, The other reason could be, and there may be a reflection, there may be a reflection from the cell, there may be transmission from the cell, the junction of the cell is not optimized. So these are the things we will see two lectures later, okay. When we look at the design of the solar cell, we will see what are the other parameters that affects the efficiency of a solar cell.
One more doubt regarding that absorption length, that is the physical length of the material which is required, is it so, sir?
Yes, that is the physical length, yeah. Physical thickness of the material that is required to absorb a given photon, a given wavelength of the photon.
Sir, is it thickness or length of the material? Which one is this?
It is the thickness. So, it is the thickness perpendicular to the surface from where light is entering. Okay, so if you are talking, so if my cell, if I am talking about this is the material and my light is coming from this direction, then this is the thickness, this is the absorption length I am talking about for a given, okay. So, if this is the surface perpendicular to the light, so in this direction I am talking about.
Sir, one more, it is not exactly related to the photovoltaic theory, actually can we learn something from the, what do you call, sunflower tracking?
Yeah, definitely, you can learn from many things in the nature. Sunflower is one example. And that is what is the sun tracking is all about, right? So you actually keep your module perpendicular to the sun rays, so that the amount of light going inside the semiconductor is higher. If your light is coming at some angle, then you know some of the light may also get reflected. So that is a problem. So if you are fixing your module in the afternoon, it is fine, but in the morning and in the evening, your light will come and get reflected also because of the small angle with respect to the plane of the glass. But if it is perpendicular, then it is fine. So, if you track your module, then actually your module is intercepting more radiation.
Yes, sir. But if you go for tracking, we have to consider for the energy used for that tracking also regarding.
Typically the energy used for the tracking is very small. You know, because you are actually, you know, remember how much is the your DC motor, AC motor, they runs at the 2000 RPM, 1500 RPM, right? Rounds per minute. In a solar module tracking, you have to track only half a round per day. So, actually your energy requirement is not much. The total generation is given 1 megawatt solar radiation is 2000 kilowatt hour per meter square per year, efficiency 10%, and we have to calculate the area. Answer come approximately so and so. Okay. So, by the way, that question was there to confuse you a little bit. When you want to calculate the area of your module, you do not need the information about, basically you want to, you are calculating for the watt peak power, right? So, when you want to calculate the module area, so solar radiation requirement, information about solar radiation is not required. Very simple, you know, when you have, for example, efficiency of the module is 10%, what does it mean? Under the standard test condition, you get the solar radiation of 1000 watt per meter square. That is a standard test condition, okay. Under this condition, you know, manufacturers defines the rating of their module. So, when you define the rating of module, what I said, it is not the watt rating, it is watt peak rating, right. So, P as a subscript is used, watt peak. What does it mean? So, if my module is 10% and if it is rated at standard test condition, which always should be, it means that out of this 10% radiation can be converted. Okay, so out of 1000 watt per meter square, 10% of the solar radiation will be converted into the electrical power. Okay, so this becomes how much? This becomes 100 watt per meter square, 100 watt peak actually, not watt, 100 watt peak per meter square. Now, what in my question I told you, not 1 megawatt, I have not given 1 megawatt, what I told you? 1 megawatt peak, 1 megawatt peak, remember. So, now, if I divide 1 megawatt peak by this amount, which is 100 watt peak per meter square, I get my answer in meter square, which is 10,000 meter square, okay. So, my module area requirement is 10,000 meters. There is no need of using any solar radiation information. And remember, we are talking about not 1 megawatt, I am talking about 1 megawatt peak. And therefore, using this rated condition, I will get this information. I hope it is clear. Next question, how can we recycle the solar cell if there any recycling plant? Why? Because it's bring garbage after 25 years. Good that you are worrying about the environment so much. By the way, I told you in the introduction also that silicon panel is consist of a glass, aluminium and silicon itself, and all these materials are completely recyclable. Remember, I will tell you in the lecture when we will discuss the manufacturing of silicon, that silicon is manufactured from very kind of raw material, silicon oxide, which is mainly available in the form of sand, etcetera. So from the sand actually we can extract silicon in the form of ingot and wafer and make solar cell. So I'm sure when there is a pure silicon available in the module and in the glass and in the aluminum in the frame, it definitely we can be able recycle it. So I don't think recycling will be an issue. Okay, in the energy band diagram, what does the space represent on x axis? Yeah, space is basically I'm talking about distance, x axis. In the energy band diagram, y axis is energy, potential energy of electrons, and x axis is the distance, x. What is the significance of x axis? It's simple, the distance, right? When I'm talking about, okay, let me go to the whiteboard again. You still could not sort your problem. So when I'm talking, so for example, this is my solar, it's my semiconductor, right? So this is my x thickness, or let's say length, right? So when I'm seeing that, what is the energy level of electron at this point, 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 and maybe when I make my solar cell, I'll actually get a p-n junction, right? So p and n. So this is a physical space, physical distance I'm talking about. So when we draw the energy band diagram like conduction band and valence band, so I'm actually talking about physical distance only. Okay, so this axis is my physical distance. So this is my conduction band, this is my valence band, and this is my potential energy. And this is representing this x, okay, this x here, you can say it is x also. So this x here represents this x, same physical distance we are talking about. Okay, Amal Jyoti.
Why the mobility of electron and photons at holes are different?
Yeah, good question. Why is the mobility of electrons and holes are different? So you have to consider the, so you know what is a hole? It is absence of electron, right? So suppose in a matrix, when there are many electrons, there are many electrons are sitting there, okay, and suppose this is the empty place which is available. This is the empty place which is available, okay. The mobility is different because of what is called the effective mass of the electron is different from the effective mass of the hole, okay. So basically, the hole appears it to be a heavier particle. Why it is like that? Because once this electron is going from this space to this space, okay, once electron goes from this space to this space, there are very, this electron will have binded by many other electrons. So there are other forces that is working on electrons. It has to break that forces and then get yourself itself free and then go there. Okay, so it is equivalent to that the hole moving from that side to this side. Okay, electron going from here to here is equivalent to hole moving from here. So the difference in the effective mass of the electron and hole comes from the fact that the forces that acts upon on an electron before it actually can, you know, unbind itself from one location and go to the other location, that is different for both the cases. That results in a difference in effective mass, and that results in the difference in the mobility of the carriers and diffusion also of the carriers. So normally electrons move faster than the holes. Is there any question? Jaycham Rajendra? Hello. Yeah, go ahead.
Is there a particle called phonon? We searched in the internet, but we didn't find anything about phonon related to photovoltaics.
Are you sure that, okay. So phonon is a particle which is described or which is used to describe the lattice vibration. Okay, so energy within the semiconductor can also flow from vibration to vibration, and phonon similar to a photon is a particle. The difference between the photon and phonon is that the phonon is considered a high mass and less energy particle, and therefore, you know, when I showed you that if I go to the whiteboard, so if I showed you that if you have the indirect band gap semiconductor, you have the momentum axis here, you have the energy axis here, okay. So we have the valence band of semiconductor which is not aligned with the conduction band, right? And this potential, this momentum comes from the theory of the atoms itself, right? So now if I want to excite an electron from my valence band to a conduction band, right? So this electron requires a change in energy and it requires change in momentum also, right? Now the photon is a very light particle, the mass of the photon is like transfer minus 31 or so. So therefore, if my electron absorbs a photon, it can only result in change in energy, the momentum change cannot occur. So where does this momentum change then will occur? It occurs because of what is called the phonon, okay? And this phonon is associated with the, it's a particle which you can use in reference to the lattice vibration, okay? So you can understand it's a kind of physical vibration of the bonds that you are talking about. So some of the energy that can be taken or given to the bonds in terms of the phonon, and this is considered as a heavy particle but having less energy. So this transition which will be caused by the phonon and this transition will be caused by photon, okay? So when you are having indirect band gap material, you will have the photon and phonon transition. But I am sure if you search on the net, you will find lot of material on phonon also, particularly in the books of semiconductor physics, quantum theory. If you go, you can find the details.
Okay sir, thank you.
Thank you very much. All the best.